in our 25th year. The following is a special presentation of HBO Sports.
Glorified street ball. The red, white, and blue ball was viewed as a joke. The three-point shot was viewed as a gimmick.
We were free and wild, and the times were free and wild.
We was entertaining. I mean, that was my style of play, playground ball.
It's just a good feeling. You just open up and let your creative juices flow.
Whatever was outrageous anywhere else, it was that much more outrageous in the ABA because, what the hell, we didn't have anything to lose.
Long Shots, the life and times of the American Basketball Association.
Good evening, everyone. This huge, record-breaking crowd here at McNichols Arena about to bear witness to one of the most spectacular events in professional basketball, the slam dunk contest.
For a league that got very little respect, the ABA always knew how to put on a great show. High-flying, fast-paced, over-the-rim kind of stuff. We were Showtime before Showtime ever got near L.A. The three-point shot, the multi-million dollar contracts, the tomahawk dunks, all those things found a home in the ABA. The ABA was a long shot, a cult act, the invisible league. If you didn't buy a ticket, chances are you didn't see us play. But man, could we play.
Now the doctor goes to work.
Before we came along, who would have thought anyone could dunk from the foul line?
The American Basketball Association existed in the shadows of professional sports for nine wild seasons, from the late 60s to the mid-70s. From its humble beginnings, the not-so-secret goal of the league was to force a merger with the more powerful, established NBA. Ultimately, the ABA failed to achieve the commercial success of its renegade model, the American Football League. But in an era when America's most visible sports icons were rebels like Joe Namath and Muhammad Ali, the ABA was the ultimate rebel league. From its inception, its intent was to shake up the sports establishment, and it did. One of the league's founding fathers was Californian Dennis Murphy, a sports entrepreneur who believed the country would accept a second basketball league. By the fall of 67, Murphy had helped round up 11 ownership groups. The price of admission? A franchise fee of $5,000.
At that time, we were all a bunch of young guys with a lot of ambition, and we were just a dream, a thought, not a good possibility. I think people felt, who are these turkeys from California and New York that are trying to put together a league?
The ABA's first commissioner was George Mikan, a former NBA star who brought instant credibility and new ideas to the upstart league.
I felt that there was room for another league. I told him about our ideas as to what we would like to accomplish, where we would like to be, and that we will seek parity with the NBA.
It was at that time that he showed the red, white, and blue ball. It was at that time we talked about the three-point play. And George was the one who brought those things out to the public and to the media. And because it was George Mikan, it had credibility.
We're hiring coaches, general managers. We have the sites. We have a schedule ready. And come October, we'll be in business.
All the league needed now was players. And so the search was on.
Every ABA team had some sort of open tryout just to find out who the players were in that particular city. roughly 150 guys try out, all shapes and sizes. They just threw out an invitation to anybody that wanted to try to play.
Some guys were just trying out so they could go tell their girlfriend that they tried out for a professional basketball team.
We'll be here for a month if we don't start cutting people right now. We're going to cut them when they start throwing up or when they miss a layup, they're out of here.
And out of that 150, they must have cut 100 in the first day.
When the open tryouts turned out to be more a gimmick than a source for finding talent, teams sought out college players with enticements of more money and added playing time in the new league.
When I got drafted by the Pacers, I didn't even know what they were. You know, welcome to the American Basketball Association, the telegram said, and I said, what is this?
I was drafted on the 12th round by the Los Angeles Lakers, and I was drafted on the 7th round in the ABA by the Los Angeles Stars, and to me, that was a no-brainer. I had to sign with the LA Stars because they offered me a bonus and an opportunity to make the team, and the Lakers offered me a tryout and a free Jerry West t-shirt.
Desperate for quality players, the ABA wasn't picky. Even those with tainted backgrounds were welcomed with open arms. The league grabbed Connie Hawkins, who'd been banned from the NBA for an alleged point-shaving scandal in college. The same was true for Roger Brown, a perennial ABA star. Another NBA outcast was Doug Moe, who'd been playing in Italy when his former college teammate, Larry Brown, convinced him to take a chance on the new league.
Doug and I decided we'd go down to New Orleans and explore the possibility. And the general manager of the Buccaneers was Sean Morton Downey III.
I didn't know anything about basketball. All I knew was a bunch of tall guys who threw balls into the air, into hoops.
Couldn't find New Orleans Buccaneers on the billboard at the Barone building, and then I saw Sean Morton Downey's name. I think he was with American Can Company or something. We go up the elevator and got in his office, and sure enough, there was a placard on his desk that said,
General Manager of the Canteen Corporation of Louisiana.
And when Doug and I walked in, he whipped it around and
it said, Sean M. Downey, President General Manager, New Orleans Buccaneers.
I feel pretty good about it right now.
They were sure the check was going to bounce.
Felt like, I guess we didn't cash until we got home, but I felt like I was running to the bank to see if it was going to bounce.
They came back the next day, they were dumbfounded. The check's cleared.
Which was mind-boggling.
They had money to be in New Orleans and have some fun, and they started to believe we were going to end up playing ball.
The ABA began its first season with 11 teams. Among the now forgotten were the New Orleans Buccaneers, Anaheim Amigos, Denver Rockets, Houston Mavericks, New Jersey Americans, and the Minnesota Muskies. Joining them were ABA fixtures, like the Kentucky Colonels and the Indiana Pacers, teams that would endure the life of the league. In Oakland, Pat Boone was the team's president and part owner, and it was his celebrity that helped bring the league its first superstar.
I wanted each team to go out and contact at least one NBA player.
He was saying, go get the biggest guy you can sign. Pay him whatever you can pay, whatever he wants.
The person who answered the call was Rick Barry.
Lured to the Oaks with part ownership and a chance to play for a coach who happened to be his father-in-law, Rick Barry, the NBA's leading scorer, jumped leagues.
The opportunity came about that the new league was going to be formed, and there was going to be a team in Oakland, which was in the Bay Area, which is where I wanted to stay. I remember some of the stories written by the press there, money hungry, no sense of values, backstabbing, I mean, the bad guy.
The bad guy would have been good for the league if he had played. The NBA challenged Barry's contract, and the courts forced him to miss the first season. Without their superstar, the Oaks were in trouble, and their owner knew it.
My first trepidation came when we had a press conference at the sports arena to announce to LA that they had a team in the ABA. So we were going to demonstrate how the three-point play worked. I and these two or three guys had been signed, now we're going to be paid to play, started popping away at the basket. And I made more three-pointers than they did. And I thought, wait a minute, I don't think this is the way it's supposed to go.
The ABA's first game,
between the Oakland Oaks and Anaheim Amigos was played on October 13th, 1967. Fittingly, it was Friday the 13th. The league got off to a rambunctious start. Play was rough and ragged, but some who rose above it were Pittsburgh's Chico Vaughn, Red Robins of New Orleans, and the infamous Laverne Jelly Tart. The ABA's first champions were the Pittsburgh Pipers, and the MVP was Connie Hawkins. For years, everyone had heard about Hawkins' great talent. Now the ABA had given him a national stage. Unfortunately, while the Hawks soared, attendance did not. In its first few seasons, the ABA averaged little more than 3,000 fans a game.
There was a bunch of people disguised as empty seats. But I think for the most part, the attitude for the people there was that it wasn't an NBA franchise. They're not NBA ball players, so they're inferior ball players.
I had played in the NBA for a while with the Knicks, and I'd gotten cut, and I had a taste at a big time. And while the ABA wasn't exactly all peaches and cream the first year.
Players would stand there during the national anthem and actually count the people. I know one night in Memphis, there were 58 people in the stands.
And in New Orleans, we had a very, really good hardcore group of fans of about 100.
28 people. There were 28 people at a game. Now, I'm going to tell you something. You don't think it takes a lot of personal pride to want to go out and give your best effort. With 28 people, why? There are more people on the bench and at the scorer's table than there were in the stands. What am I doing here? I mean, this is like, this is unbelievable.
In Memphis once, there was a great basketball player, Johnny Newman, University of Mississippi. They signed him, and part of his deal was he got 5,000 tickets a game. 5,000 tickets a game. He couldn't give them away. He would go to the barbershop and say, if you'll give me a haircut, I'll give you a ticket. He would leave them as tips in coffee shops. I always remember in Pittsburgh, they brought Muhammad Ali in for an exhibition with four local fighters. And that was before the game. They set up the ring at the end of the basketball court. There were about 8,000 or 9,000 people came to watch Muhammad Ali. He got through, everybody got up and left. When the teams came out to play, there were about 500 people left in the arena. And the PR director said he made a major mistake of not locking the doors after the fight.
For the most part, fan support didn't improve over time.
One night against San Antonio, we announced a crowd of 806. And I sat there during halftime, and I started counting the people in the stands. And my best guess was that there were really about 400 people at the game. And I went up to Rudy Martsky, who then was the Spirits director of operations, and I said, Rudy, you know, it's bad enough we've got an announced crowd of about 800. There's really like 400 people here. He says, you know, you little wise ass, why don't you just go back over there and broadcast the game and mind your own business? Did it ever occur to you that maybe some of these people are in the restroom or at the concession stand? I said, Rudy, let's test your premise. Let's suppose there were 10,000 people here. What are the odds that at any given moment, 5,000 of them are relieving themselves or buying a hot dog? There's no chance of that. There's 400 people here. He said, I'm going to belch you. Get out of here.
Part of the ABA's problem was the conditions, size, and availability of the league's arenas. In many cities, ABA games weren't given top priority. Some teams had two or three home courts. There were even games played in front of high school bands, glorified high school gyms. Life in the early days of the ABA wasn't exactly the big time.
Miami one year, they played in a hangar out by the pier. And if it was really hot and muggy, they would open one end of the hangar and air would come. I mean, it would change the trajectory of the ball when a guy's shooting if the wind's blowing. And one night it was raining, and it's raining on one end of the court. They got to stop the game and close the doors.
I remember one time playing down in Miami. We had the referee mad, and there was a timeout, and he slammed the ball down on the floor like referees do and was standing there waiting for the timeout to be over. And he reached down to pick up the ball, and it had rolled all the way down the floor. That floor was tilted down there, you know.
The biggest shock I had, as far as an arena was concerned, was the first year of the ABA. In 1967, we went to New York. We traveled across the George Washington Bridge to Teaneck, New Jersey, to play in the old armory.
At timeouts, they would bring a mallet out and hammer the end of the floor to get the boards back in place between plays.
And then later we went over to Comac, and it was an ice skating arena.
We went out to play, and the ball boy came in and said, the temperature on the floor is 10 degrees.
There was a complete sheet of ice on the top of the floor. And we went out there, and we actually played on it, and we were actually dribbling the ball, sliding. Somebody would go take a layup. They would slide a good 10 feet, like this here, just slide before they take the shot.
We got $10 a day on the road. We didn't have a trainer travel with us, and I learned to tape myself. You washed your own uniforms. Jimmy Jones asked for a jock strap, and the guy told him, well, I gave you two earlier in the year.
Rudy Martsky's a columnist for USA Today. He was one of the original PR men for the Miami Floridians or something, and I think he saw the handwriting on the wall when he came back to work one day and they'd sold all his furniture. I mean, his office was gone because they needed the money.
Bob Bass, the coach and general manager, said to me, hey, Rudy, before you get started today, clean out your desk. And I said, clean out my desk? What? He says, well, yeah, look, I sold it. I said, really? He says, yeah, look, and by the way, he's also going to be up here about 11 a.m. If you can help him carry it to his new office, too, okay? And the guy comes up. He's kind of shaggy-haired and beard and all sorts of stuff. So there I am, helping carry the desk into the elevator, down the floor, into his office. And that night, I got home, and I'm watching the news. And all of a sudden, I noticed, there's the guy. It's Jerry Rubin from the Chicago 7. This is the 1972 Democratic Convention in Miami Beach. And here he is from the Chicago 7. My desk got sold to Jerry Rubin.
Typical of the ABA, even teams that won, lost. For Pat Boone, the excitement of his Oakland Oaks winning the league championship was balanced by the reality of his bank book.
I want to show this to Elizabeth Taylor because she's got some very nice jewelry, but she doesn't have a ring that costs $2.5 million. Now this ring, this Oakland Oaks championship ring, cost me $2.5 million hard, cold bucks, and I got to go to 10 games. Now, you've heard of scalping. Nobody ever got scalped to the tune of $250,000 a game.
The ABA's signature was its colorful red, white, and blue ball. It was innovative and unique to the league, as was another ABA curiosity, the three-point shot. Although both creations were criticized by the basketball establishment, they gave the league instant personality.
Identification, something different, something unusual, something that people could put their teeth into. When we first talked about it, there was some very strong opposition to it. You had people in the league who were the traditionalists.
Of course, the reaction from the traditionalists was they were aghast.
I'm an old-timer, and I'm sort of against the ball because I think it detracts from the game to a certain degree.
I said, that is the worst-looking ball I've ever seen. It'll make us a total laughingstock.
People kept kidding it about it being a beach ball.
And suggested that they ought to have a seal so it could be on the seal's nose.
And players would come in, and they'd pick up the ball, and they'd say, the ball is too heavy. Another player would pick the ball up and say, the ball's too light. Another player would say, the ball's been painted and it slips on my fingers.
When we first put it into effect, coming off of the presses and that, it was slippery.
Couldn't handle the ball. I mean, it was brand new, but they had problems with the dot. It was just too slick to handle. There was all kinds of dropping and slippage of the ball and a lot of complaining.
I remember the first time they brought it out, guys would pass it, and you would hold your hands out, and the ball would hit you in the face because you were used to watching it spin all the time.
It was the first exhibition game that the Dallas franchise played against the New Orleans Bucks. Just before game time, we'd received a shipment of the red, white, and blue ABA basketballs. And the first ones, they were a little bit off. And the ball was very lively, and it bounced off the rim and the backboard. And for 10 minutes, there was no score in the game.
It really threw me for a loop. It took me close to half a season to focus back on my regular game. Every time I shot that basketball, I was watching that ball in flight and thinking, oh, what pretty colors.
The good players, they utilized spin, and they could see the spin, so could the audience. And it got to where you liked seeing that red, white, and blue ball spinning toward the basket.
We
when you had the right rotation, the perfect rotation on the ball, and it was going red, white, and blue around and around, it really was something to see.
And somehow the way they could loop and flip and finger roll, it had a lot more glamour and pizzazz.
After a rough start, the distinctive tricolor ball had become an unqualified commercial success.
Everywhere you went after a couple of years, the kids were playing in the playground with a red, white, and blue basketball.
The first 3 or 4 years of the ABA's existence, the biggest hole in their game was the big man.
The main difference, I believe, between basketball as played by the National Basketball Association and the American Basketball Association now is purely one of size. We do not have the superstar big 7-foot center.
The ABA came along and says, well, we don't have Bill Russell and we don't have Wilt Chamberlain.
And we don't have the superstar 6'6" and 6'7" guards.
How are we going to solve this ABA problem?
Remember, it's only in the ABA that you get an extra point for sinking that long shot, making for some exciting dead-eye shooting in clutch situations.
Move the ball, take the break. I mean, there were many a time coming down the floor, Slick would be yelling at me, you know, take the three, Billy, pull up and shoot the three.
The ABA feels that this extra incentive to shoot from farther out causes the defense to open up.
That opened up the defenses, so now you could drive from the wings and get under the defenses, and there was more action.
Create a more exciting game for the fans. Give the team that's behind an opportunity to close the gap quickly with long three-point shots.
It gives the little man more of a chance to balance up his value in the game compared to the big man.
The ABA soon became a shooter's paradise. Among the best were Kentucky's Darryl Carrier and Billy Keller of the Indiana Pacers. But the master of the three-point shot was the league's all-time leading scorer, Louis Dampier, who played all 9 seasons with the Kentucky Colonels.
I shot 500 1 year, or maybe more, and hit almost 200 a couple years in a row.
We would come down on a two-on-one fast break. He's running to the corner to shoot a three on a two-on-one fast break. Now, when you see that for the first time, and you're a purist, you're not very happy with his shot selection.
While the three-point shot and red, white, and blue ball defined the ABA, both innovations irritated the NBA. The company line was that the new league was making a mockery of the sport.
It was something they could latch on to. They called it the funny basketball, and the three-point play, that wasn't really basketball. They kept saying, well, you know, that's not the way Naismith invented it.
I don't think it was the players that looked down on us. I think it was the close-knit type of country club atmosphere the NBA had. We have our little club, and you can't come in, and we're better than you.
The NBA at that point
was a very arrogant operation, manifested clearly by Red Auerbach's operation with the Boston Celtics.
We didn't pay much attention to it. We thought it was a bunch of guys trying to become pests.
He was the great Satan as far as the ABA was concerned because he was so anti-ABA.
They weren't playing in big cities, number one. Number two, they didn't have enough credible ball players.
Red Auerbach said, those clowns can't play basketball.
So the minor league with a couple of players. And it's always a question of how long would they continue to lose money before they folded the tent.
After 2 relatively benign seasons, it was painfully clear to the ABA that its effect on America's sports culture was almost non-existent. Even worse, the league was unstable. 6 of the original 11 franchises were already in different cities. Almost all were in financial trouble, including the defending champion Oakland Oaks, who celebrated their second year title by moving across the country to Washington, D.C. The ABA was in danger of an early demise. Something had to be done.
Almost everything we did was reactionary. So a crisis developed and we addressed the crisis, or a need developed and we addressed the need. I think the thing that distinguished the ABA is that everyone knew they had to work together if they're going to survive. So there was a forced camaraderie. It's a little bit like being on the hill at Iwo Jima. You either pulled together and did it or you weren't going to survive.
For the ABA, survival meant bending the rules, like signing Spencer Haywood when he was a college sophomore. At a time when the NBA forbid its teams from even talking to underclassmen, Haywood felt the policy was unjust.
I'm going to challenge this, you know, and they're looking at me like you're crazy. And then I said, well, but, you know, my mother won't live another 2 years down here picking cotton and scrubbing floors on her knees. She just won't. So I want to do something for my family. And everybody sort of come to an agreement and said, give it a try.
How are you going to do this and justify it publicly? And in the course of one of our after-meeting sessions of staying up all night and drinking beer and trying to figure out what it was we were going to do, we came up with the quote, the hardship draft. And for players that had a hardship, we would be able to be the benevolent sons of the American way and give them a way out.
In his first year with Denver, Haywood led the league in scoring and rebounding and was named the ABA's Rookie of the Year and Most Valuable Player. The gambit had worked. The ABA had a new strategic weapon in its fight with the NBA.
One of the theories was we wanted to draft players early, way ahead of the NBA, so that we'd have an opportunity to try to get the player signed. There were lots of drafts, all in quotation marks, secret drafts.
They're having a secret basketball draft in there.
And of course, the reason we did this was supposedly to conceal the information from the NBA so that we could go after these players without their knowledge of who was doing what.
When we were having those secret drafts, there was a lot more going on than just a draft. We would discuss among ourselves,
what is the best way to get this player into this league? And who has the best shot of doing it?
For instance, the Don Boosie case. He's drafted by Phoenix, and he's drafted by Virginia Squires. Slick Leonard calls me and says, he won't go to Virginia. He'll come to Indiana. I said, okay, so you take him.
I was drafted by the Dallas Chaparrals. I told representatives from the ABA the only team that I would be interested in playing for was the Kentucky Colonels. Well, about a week later, the Kentucky Colonels had my rights.
You didn't have to be a genius to figure out if you were in the state of Kentucky and you could have Dan Issel play on your team from Kentucky, that was much better than having Dan go to Anaheim or to go to Pittsburgh.
The consensus All-America team my senior year was myself, Bob Lanier, Rick Mount, Calvin Murphy, Charlie Scott, and Pete Maravich. And out of those six players, three went to the NBA and three went to the ABA. The players were able to stay close to where they played college basketball. I went down the road to Louisville from Kentucky. Rick went down the road from Lafayette to play for the Pacers. Charlie Scott went from North Carolina up to play for the Virginia Squires. So that year was really when the ABA started making some inroads into getting some young talent.
As a sophomore, I left Indiana University early. My father was killed when I was a senior in high school. He was a construction worker and fell from a scaffold. I thought it was an opportunity, first of all, to help my mother because she didn't work. The Pacers were a local team, and I thought that this would be a perfect fit, me being home and still being able to play pro basketball or realize my dream. And the NBA could not offer that.
They were trying to stay afloat, and the only way they could do it is sign just a few top players, giving them a lot of money. And it was either do that or close shop. So they took the gamble to do that.
Big money contracts for big time players, like the one Artis Gilmore signed with Kentucky in 1971, became commonplace in the ABA. A year later, Billy Cunningham, a perennial NBA All-Star, left the Philadelphia 76ers for the riches of the Carolina Cougars. The leagues were at war, and the ABA was winning more than its share of the battles.
The ABA was costing them money. It was driving salaries up due to the competition factor. Everyone had to live with the cloak and dagger CIA aspect of the draft every year, competing with the ABA for players. All these things added together created the ABA as a monster in the NBA eyes and the enemy.
And the enemy was about to get a new weapon. Julius Erving's arrival in 1971 transformed the league.
Once I got to Virginia, it was almost like, you know, having the chains taken off, you know, no zones, you could dunk the ball. And since, you know, I was a young free spirit during that time, I figured I could run all day, you know, jump with the best of them. And I literally said, the chains have been taken off now. Let me see if I can handle this.
He was just inventing stuff on the way to the basket. I don't think he knew. We didn't know. I know his teammates didn't know. All the Virginia Squires knew was, that guy's a whole lot better than whoever it was at Massachusetts. He ain't even the same player, not even on the same planet.
We play a wide open type game, and you know, we want to take advantage of different opportunities in different situations. I grab a rebound and, you know, fill the lanes, and any two defenders that they can get back, you know, there's always a possibility that we're big enough to go over there.
We were going to be playing the Virginia Squires in an exhibition game in St. Petersburg, and I called the Squires PR guy, and I said, hey, I'm doing this release for the game, and I understand you have this new outstanding player, a guy named Julius Erving there, and can you tell me about him? And he says, I can't. He's indescribable.
Erving's talent was extraordinary. His game, revolutionary. And the league followed his lead.
I developed my own style of play, which is at times sort of a playground style.
You're feeling your way, you get out of position a lot, you get off balance, and you can make up for a lot of your mistakes by recovering and pretty much doing some spectacular things and superhuman type things.
I was blessed with natural attributes that enabled him to do things that mere mortals weren't able to do.
And he would elevate. And as he would go up,
his hips go by my head, and I'm standing at the foul line, and I said, no way. And I turn around and I look, and there he goes gliding in the air.
The way I described it was, he scares the ball in the basket.
Kind of built a little bit of reputation. People started calling me the doctor at that time.
Do you like the name?
Oh, yeah, I love it. I think the kids really love it, though, because Julius Erving might be a difficult name for them to pronounce. And Dr. J is very catchy, and they don't often forget it.
And I never had so much attention on the bench. You see games, you see guys on the bench are looking around, right? The first year Doc was there, they watched the game, because every night it was something new.
Despite the fact that you're an opposing coach, does he sometimes thrill you because you're a basketball enthusiast?
No doubt about it. I think anybody who loves this game looks at this fella and says, wow, that's the way the game should be played.
And there is Julius Erving. Look at that move behind the back. Oh!
If Julius would have gone to the NBA right away, the first thing was that you had to play fundamental. You don't make passes up in the air. You don't do what is not fundamentally sound. People would try things in the ABA that you would not try in the NBA because you had the freedom to do that. The ABA let people understand that creativity was good at basketball.
We had a lot of guys that were from the playground. The coaches in the league let them play this style of play, and it became part of the game because, you know what, it worked.
We were averaging 15 to 20 dunks a game.
And all of a sudden, you get this run, shoot, and holler game, which became a playground game with talented professional players.
We wasn't getting no media, you know, we wasn't getting no TV, you know, we barely got radio, so, you know, we were trying to establish ourselves any way we can, but the only way we really could have done it is being able to fill that basket up, and that's what the fans really admired about the ABA, you know, it's our fast-paced style, you know, you had a chance to really show your skills and make some great moves and stuff because you stayed in the flow of the game, and, you know, that's where I feel basketball is supposed to be played.
Few played basketball quite like 19-year-old George Gervin when he came to the ABA. At 6'7", the ludicrously skinny Gervin was perfectly suited to a league that encouraged the flamboyant rather than the physical.
I played basketball to entertain our fans. You know, I wanted the fans to go home and say, wow, did you see that move Ice laid down today?
The Iceman would be gliding. And you'd say, we have him under control tonight. And the guy with the stats would say, you're right, he only has 37. And you would go, how many? Because he would do it so effortlessly.
Like the times, the game had changed.
We were a non-traditional league with a non-traditional ball, with non-traditional approaches, with non-traditional owners. I think that we were a non-traditional entity in an era that started to recognize that tradition wasn't always the way to go.
Although it was, quote unquote, you know, professional league, there was something about it that ran counter to all the stress and strain of what was happening in our society.
The revolution. I think we all kind of sensed that. Since we were looked at that way, then the expression of the era was easier for us to bring out.
There was some serious flavor in the ABA that didn't exist in the NBA. The NBA was viewed as being the brown ball league, you know, it was older, more traditional, and, you know, their protocol was already established.
And in the ABA, there was no protocol. We all did what we wanted to do, and everybody had beards and mustaches and bell-bottom pants and the loud-colored shirts and the big afros, and they were able to have their own identity.
The bigger the afro, and actually the more militant you could look, the better it was. And when they ran, the thing flopped, and then when they took off, you know, just kind of flowed back, just kind of accentuated nastiness.
The best character was Darnell Hillmans. He was another guy that played for the Pacers, terrific leaper. Darnell's was like a mushroom cloud, looked like the scene of Bikini in 1946 or something like that, sitting right on top of his head.
Big afros were in, and I decided, well, I'm going to grow me one and get it just the way I want it, not realizing that this would be one of the things that everyone remembered you by, and everywhere you went, that's what they would look forward to. Is, oh, there's Darnell, he's got all of that hair.
Darnell taught me how to do my hair. So we shared secrets with one another. That was something I think was probably unheard of in the NBA.
In the early 70s, the NBA still considered itself a vastly superior league. That attitude changed after some surprisingly competitive exhibition games, as if using the ABA ball wasn't humbling enough.
Reality set in. Hey, they're winning some of these games. I mean, that shook people up. I didn't think they'd win some of these games. And I, frankly, was astonished that such a thing could happen. I was completely blown away by the idea that Billy Paltz, the Whopper, could play with Dave Cowens and played a terrific game. And that opened my eyes. And from that point on, I'll tell you, I went from up on that perch with them to right down here saying, whoa, baby, you guys had better stop being so hardy because this other league has some players.
After years of disgrace, the ABA had grown up. It was now the in place, especially in areas the NBA had overlooked, like Utah, where the Stars enjoyed tremendous fan support and won the 1971 championship with players like Zelmo Beatty, Ron Boone, and Willie Wise.
These are the Stars, and they are the champions of the Western Division of the ABA. Fantastic crowd here at the airport to welcome our champions.
The Kentucky Colonels were another stable and proficient franchise. The Colonels had a winning record in 8 of their 9 ABA seasons. They played in the championship series 3 times and won the title in 1975. But by far, the ABA's preeminent team was the Indiana Pacers.
Who's your favorite player on the Pacers?
I like Darnell Hillman.
Tom Boosie.
Freddie Lewis.
Billy Keller.
Billy Keller.
Why?
I don't know, he's just cute.
Shoots these three-pointers, it just turns me on.
George McGinnis.
I like George McGinnis.
What do you like about Big George?
Everything.
And it was a love affair that began to blossom. You could go to the Coliseum, which held 10,000 people. The roar was so deafening, you couldn't hear the vendor who was trying to take your cocoa. Everybody in this community had a role with the team. Everybody felt like they owned the team.
We all liked each other. We were like a big family. There was no color lines. There was nothing. Even during the off season, it was everybody together. We'd go out and do some things that I can't say on camera, but we'd all have a good time.
Take over out there. Now call them on the way up the floor. Let's go.
Do it.
We'll keep it moving.
I said, if we win three in a row on the road, then I'll have a party up at the room for you. Well, then I had to change it. I had to change to four on the road and five on the road because, babe, these guys got the place where they were playing for that party. And I couldn't afford it.
The Pacers played in five ABA championship games and won three, including two in a row in 1972 and 1973. They were unlike any other ABA team, a model organization in every aspect of the game, the envy of the league both on and off the court.
Teams wanted to be more like the Pacers. You know, they wanted to have a small point guard who could shoot three-pointers like a Billy Keller. Some long-range guys like Roger Brown, Bob Nedelicki. And some power players inside like Mel Daniels, George McGinnis, Donnell Hellman. They always got the crowd involved in the game. They were not a boring team to watch. They were very exciting. They were an exciting team to play against. Sometimes when you played against them, you ended up watching them. And if it was one of those nights when they just had it all in sync, they were a beautiful team to watch. And there are very few teams that have ever played the way that they played in those early NBA years.
To be kind of a lonely
not every ABA team had as much going for them as the Pacers. With most of its franchises located in small media markets, the league wasn't too humble to beg for any kind of publicity.
Covering the ABA in those days was an utter joy because players were happy to see anyone show up. Coaches, general managers, owners, whoever you wanted to talk to, bang. If you wanted to do a story, they'd send you a plane ticket. They'd do anything to market their programming.
I wrote a great story about a player in Miami. The next morning, he sent a prostitute to my room. I opened the door, it was a beautiful lady, and I said, what are you doing here? And she said, I've been paid for. The player would like to tell you how much he enjoyed the story you wrote about him yesterday.
We felt in the ABA that we needed to give the fans not just good basketball, but good entertainment, liven up the games, get it to be where a person would come out and spend $5, $6 and have a wonderful night out.
Everything was a giveaway.
Every time in Indiana that a player made a three-point basket, you got 10 cents off a gallon of gasoline.
We had ice cream eating contests.
Girl Scouts night, free Cub Scouts night.
Indians wrestling alligators at half court.
They were creative out of necessity, perhaps. These guys, again, were businessmen, and they're saying, well, now, wait a minute. We've got to be a little different here. We're not going to be on television. We've got to make the guy leave the arena and think, geez, I was entertained tonight. This was fun.
Early on, the ABA recognized the importance of promoting and marketing its players. One of the first to benefit was Wendell Ladner, a marginal player with an unusual number of female fans.
He would dive on the floor after balls. He would jump over press tables. He would do it all. Most of the time, he was looking for a young lady's lap to jump in.
He looked like Rhett Butler. He had women all over him all the time.
That was a well-earned reputation, I would say. He was the only guy I'd ever seen on an airplane. By the time we got off the plane, he had the phone number of every stewardess on the airplane. He could collect them all the way up and down the aisle.
Wendell was the ABA's answer to Burt Reynolds. He would fix his hair at halftime. He would fix his hair at timeouts. And we even did a poster of Wendell laying on the benches within the locker room. There are very, very few of them left today. They are collector's item for a lot of young ladies.
The 1975 All-Star Game proved that not all ABA promotions were foolproof.
The gifts were just unbelievable. Everything from fine wines to bowling balls to luggage to radios to cameras, even to fishing lures. Everybody received the royal treatment. Willie Nelson played. Nobody had ever seen anything like it. But my biggest task was to create an award for the most valuable player in the game. We came up with the idea of getting a quarter horse. We traded with a horse trader from South Texas and got a quarter horse that was supposedly wonderful. named Tough Julie.
A Texas quarter horse by the name of Tough Julie. No, we're not talking about Julius Irving of the New York Nets, but Tough Julie, a three-year-old Texas quarter horse, and the most valuable player will receive that quarter horse, plus a saddle and bridle and all of the things a good cowboy should have.
Freddie Lewis turned out to be the most valuable player. We awarded Freddie the horse, and he got a saddle.
And I put the hat on my head, and the hat wouldn't go anywhere but right on the side of my head because my afro was so big. The horse never got any of its shots.
3 weeks later, Tough Julie died, sadly, and Freddie lost his all-star gift.
Surrounded by hype and hoopla, an ABA game felt like a circus sideshow. In many arenas, the play wasn't always the thing. Like Miami, where the weather was hot and the ball girls hotter.
We're sitting here in an area, South Florida, that didn't care much about pro basketball. We used to say that our mascot was some 68-year-old guy with a cane. So we were looking for these extra things that might draw fans, anything you think. And one of the things we came up with was the ball girls.
It was marketing at its best. During their four mundane seasons in the sun, the Floridians were a team whose ball girls made more of an impression than the players. Must have been the uniforms.
These were some serious bikinis that these gals had.
Nobody's ever said that they didn't pay attention to a pretty woman.
They always try to disrupt the opposing team at the free throws and stuff by planting them right there underneath the basket.
They might even stand up and wiggle a little bit when the opposition was shooting free throws.
Anytime a team played on TV, you could never get a married guy to sit on the end of the bench. It may be the only chair left down there for them to sit in, but because they didn't want to hear from their wives when they got home, they were not going to sit down at the end of the bench. If you were a rookie, you didn't have a choice. You were going to move. When the games were not on TV, everybody wanted to sit at the end of the bench.
After the 1972 season, Rick Barry, who had helped the New York Nets rise to ABA prominence, returned to the NBA. A year later, when Julius Irving threatened to jump leagues and play for the NBA's Atlanta Hawks, the Nets jumped in. The team in the largest media market set its sights on the ABA's signature player.
We stepped up and put up a tremendous amount of money, and the league put up some money, and we signed Julius to a gigantic contract, nothing like it in basketball at that point. Nothing in the NBA like that at that point. Nobody in our league would have done it except us. Obviously, we did it for selfish reasons for ourselves and also for the league.
It was in New York that the legend of Julius Irving really took flight. Dr. J had become basketball's most unique talent.
Julius had a way about him. It might just be one thing that he did in the game. People never forgot. You know, it was one move. People would take that home with them, and they would say, wow, I've never seen anything like that before.
Someone would say, hey, did you see the move that Julius Irving made on that Tuesday night in 1973 at Freedom Hall in Louisville? And so some guy would say, yeah, I saw it. And then he'd embellish his version of it. No, he went around three guys and then underneath the fourth guy and hung in the air for 3 seconds. No. It was two guys, and then he leapfrogged the other two guys, and he held it with his left hand and switched it to his right hand and dunked it. And they're like fish stories.
All around the league, whenever Julius came to their town, they would sell out because they wanted to come and see this guy they called the doctor. And he was just putting on a show for everyone.
The first fast break that he was on, he did a whirlwind in the lane and slam dunk over the top of Artis Gate. I saw over 16,000 people in our building stand up, hitting hands, bumping and doing their thing. I said, this guy is turning our building against us.
We were going to put him on the cover. We wanted to get a picture of him dunking, but you could never depend in a game that this was going to happen. And he got held up coming out the chute because he'd been interrupted by a rabbi and his son from Schenectady, whom Julius had met someplace before. And Julius had to stop and talk to this guy and do autographs for the kid and so forth. And he came over to me at the press table and said, gee, I'm sorry I'm late and I can't do it now because I'm not going to be warm enough, but I'll get you one in the game. And sure enough, very shortly into the game, he intercepted a pass in the middle of the court and then just came right down the middle and went right through the roof. And we got a terrific picture of it. It was the only action ABA cover I think we ever did.
If they didn't have Julius Erving, that thing would have folded like that. He kept that league up, in my opinion, all by himself.
With Erving now basketball's brightest star, his Nets became one of the league's best teams, winning two championships. At the opposite end of the spectrum were the Spirits of St. Louis, the poster boys of the latter-day ABA. After moving from Carolina in 1974, the Spirits had assembled a colorful conglomeration of highly paid but ineffective young stars, the most successful of whom turned out to be their inexperienced broadcaster.
Freddie knocked it away and made the steal. Now he's on the front end of the break. Behind the back to Marvin. Pretty play. Two for Marvin Barnes and a great assist for Freddie Lewis.
The best basketball tape I had was a game between Syracuse and Rutgers that I'd done during my sophomore year on the campus radio station. So I took the tape, found a halfway decent sequence of about 10 possessions, and then re-recorded it, and I had the engineer turn the treble down and the bass up so I would sound older. I mean, all of us at Syracuse, all the kids from the Northeast, were all doing a poor man's Marv Albert anyway.
Left side of the lane, the short jump, Marvin, yes!
On the court, the Spirits were an aptly named, talented collection of, well, free spirits. None more so than Marvin Barnes.
This guy was one of the greatest raw talents you have ever seen. And when he wanted to, he had a great heart for the game. When it came to making the bus, making the plane, making practice, that was a different story. One day, we played in Louisville. And Louisville's not that far from St. Louis, but they're in different time zones. Louisville Eastern time zone, St. Louis Central time zone. So we play a game and lose at Freedom Hall. The next morning, we gather at the airport, and the traveling secretary hands out the itinerary. It says, TWA flight 305, depart Louisville 8 a.m., arrive St. Louis 7:56. Marvin comes walking up to me. Bro, come over here. I don't know about you, but I am not getting on any time machine. I was afraid he thought that if we boarded this plane and flew indefinitely, we'd begin to, you know, like meet Lincoln or Jefferson or something, just keep on going.
But the real question was, could the ABA keep going? Still desperate for gate attractions, teams continued to overpay for top players. In 1974, the Utah Stars signed Moses Malone, the first player ever to go directly from high school to the pros. A year later, David Thompson, the NBA's number one draft pick and the player whose talents most closely resembled Julius Erving, chose the ABA's Denver Nuggets. But for the ABA, the cost of competing with the NBA was devastating. Hemorrhaging money, the long shot league was winning the battle for superstars, but losing the war to survive. The dying league's final season began with 10 teams, but the new Baltimore franchise folded before playing a single game, and San Diego and Utah weren't far behind. Down to 7 teams, the ABA was in danger of giving its final performance.
So the real strategy in the league was, let's keep resuscitating this thing. Let's perform CPR, which we were doing on a daily basis practically, to keep this baby going. Look, we do a deal with these guys or we're going to drop dead.
I felt, let them rot. It was only a matter of time before they were going to quit, but the owners didn't want to wait.
There were owners in the NBA that were drooling to get their hands on some of our players. I mean, there were dozens of top players that these guys coveted.
Knowing that its rival league was financially strapped and limping along, the older, aging league showed no mercy, salivating over the ABA's cachet of young talent that included some of the best players in basketball. The NBA smelled blood.
Their theory was this influx of new talent, this infusion of new talent would be a great thing for their league, but they wanted to do it on their terms and under their control.
The terms were harsh, more like a massacre than a merger. Only 4 ABA teams survived. The New York Nets, the Denver Nuggets, the Indiana Pacers, and San Antonio Spurs would all pay a heavy financial price for the privilege of joining the NBA. The last ABA game between the New York Nets and Denver Nuggets was played on May 13, 1976. Typical of the league, it was fast-paced and exciting.
Reverse! Oh, was that gorgeous!
Led by Super John Williamson, the Nets came from 20 points behind in the fourth quarter to win the championship. The wild ride was over. Sure, they made fun of the ABA, but in the end, the joke was on the basketball establishment. The no-defense, all-flash league wound up revolutionizing the sport. It taught the Brown Ball League that the game could be colorful and entertaining. All the ABA ever wanted was to let the world know how good it was. A year after the merger, there was little doubt. 5 of the 10 starters in the NBA Finals came from the ABA, and 10 of the 24 players in the All-Star Game had ABA roots. And the most valuable player that day was the doctor, Julius Erving.
And that sends everyone reeling, Julius Erving.
Like I said, for a league that got very little respect, we always did put on a great show. Yeah, it was a long shot. But as it turned out, it was a shot worth taking. And like the rest of the guys who played in the Red, White, and Blue League, I'll always be proud of the years I spent in the late, great ABA.
In association with Black Canyon Productions, this has been a presentation of HBO Sports, celebrating 25 years as the network of champions.